Okay, welcome back everyone. This is theCUBE, SiliconANGLE and Wikibon's flagship program. We go out to the events, extract the signal from the noise. We're live in Las Vegas for day one of 2 days of live coverage of the .dot conference, Splunk's conference. The hashtag is SplunkConf tweet, and we'll be happy to talk to you. Our next guest is Jesse Truck, cybersecurity engineer, Oak Ridge National Laboratory, part of the Department of Energy. You're not shut down, so that's good news.
Yeah.
You got money in the bank.
Yes.
Welcome to theCUBE.
Well, thank you. Thank you for having me.
It's always great to hear from Splunk executives about the ride they're on. Obviously, it's a rocket ship for the company. Went public, doing great on the business side. Got a great ecosystem. But talking to the customers and people who actually use the products is always the fun part. So I want to ask you, first question, you used Splunk early on, when they were first coming out, right?
Yeah.
They were like a tool.
2006, yeah.
2006, and now you've used them. So what's your take on the transformation of Splunk? What has it turned into? And then explain to the folks where it was and what it is now.
So back in 2006 when I used it, it was really just a way to look at your logs that were on more than one system without having to log into every system and grep around and things like that. Whereas now, it is actually a data analytics platform. And before, I never realized how much of a data geek I was until I had the power of Splunk in front of me. And we've been using it now to find information in all kinds of different data, not just machine logs, so that we're transforming how we make our IT decisions and what kinds of applications and platforms to purchase in the future because we can do analytics rather than just using it as a log tool.
And a lot of things, Dave and I always talk on theCUBE here about big data because we're fanatics about it. We're also data geeks. And it's one of those things, the common thread amongst folks is that when stuff is automated for them, different skills kick in, analytical skills, creative skills. What other observations can you share relative to that? Because what Splunk basically does is sets the table for you, do all this stuff, a lot of manual work, say grep around, all that stuff's done, eliminated. What new things are that you're seeing being abstracted away that Splunk's doing, if you could share with the folks out there?
So what it does for us is instead of just looking at logs or just using it as a forensics tool, we can look at trending data and do statistical analysis on things that are a very large volume. You know, we have somewhere between 6 and 12 gigabits per second most of the time running through our network. And as a security person, we have to keep an eye on all of that all the time. And it's like trying to find a speck of sand and fire hose so that the ability to do a statistical analysis on a broad, I guess I would say the broader view of all of the data that we have from all of our different appliances allows us to see things that we normally would not see. Like IDS may not catch something or this other thing might not catch something, but we can see patterns that we weren't able to see before. So before we were wandering around in the forest and all we could see was the trees, but now we can come back and we can see the whole forest.
So why Splunk? Talk about that. Is it Splunk's ability to handle diverse data sets and different data sources? Why Splunk?
So part of it is that it's become more than just a framework, but originally it's because it's a framework that allows us to just dig around in our data and look at it and drill down in a variety of ways. But now it's become an entire reporting platform, and so our other option would be some of the other tools that are primarily security management systems, security information management systems, SIMs. But we're starting to use it for non-security operational things. And so as a result, by continuing to use Splunk to mine our data and to visualize data, we can see things that we would not be able to see in a stock application that has a limited view and the less ability to drill down.
So other practitioners have said that you know, some of those stock applications that you're talking about, they might give you, you know, more within a narrow view, but none of them can handle the cross-platform, cross data sources of Splunk. I got a tweet this morning, and I want to ask you, because I like to ask practitioners, the guys are really using it. It said, because I was, you know, tweeting in the keynote, and the practitioner said, hey, with things like Elasticsearch and Logstash, which are open source capabilities, why are people still using Splunk? And I responded, well, it's because Splunk's a solution, and it's got support. But that's my answer. I'm not a practitioner. What's your answer?
So Elasticsearch and Logstash was actually the creator of Logstash, was just hired by Elasticsearch. So I suspect that they may be looking for, you know, a broader view of commercial applications in the future. but it has a limited ability to do the visualization, and especially with Splunk 6 Enterprise now, the pivot and data modeling allows you to use the information more without having to be a super techie code head. Whereas Logstash and Elasticsearch really, I don't think that they're mature for non-technical people because the UI is really simple and there's not enough layers of tools on top of it. And in addition to that, because we actually have looked at possibly using it because Splunk, you know, can be expensive if you're in a larger organization. And so with Elasticsearch and Logstash, there's a lot of manual glue you have to do to get your data in and to move, manipulate things, to get reporting out. Whereas with Splunk, I can just hand somebody an account into our search head, and they can just get data out, and I don't have to teach them how to do anything.
Right, so the value there is the productivity of the organization goes through.
Absolutely.
So you talk a little bit more about where you started using Splunk. Was it for sort of, you know, problem analysis, problem determination, and how that's evolved?
So originally it was just security logs, related logs, and so it would be machine data from syslog servers, Windows servers that were security related events, and then all of our firewall logging goes into Splunk. And so we would use it for correlating events across systems or looking up whether or not a firewall rule is being triggered or some particular connection is denied, things like that. What it's now evolved into is we use Splunk as our primary alert mechanism for a lot of our IDS and IPS traffic. So the alerts go to Splunk and then Splunk's the actual mechanism to alert us. It also, we're starting to do a lot of data analytics and visualization to see about usage trends of our network to understand our network beyond the simple, you know, is somebody trying to hack or is there malware? And it's that extra layer that of understanding what's really happening on a big picture that Splunk is giving us now. And that's where it's changed.
No, so Jesse, you're doing work in, if I understand correctly, advanced materials, clean tech, nuclear non-proliferation.
Yes.
But specifically with in a cybersecurity context, is that right?
Yeah, so my job is, my team is the security operational people that monitor the network and infrastructure of the lab, you know, basically all the computing resources. And so all these scientists and researchers that are doing that research use computing resources, and we secure and monitor those computing resources.
So talk about, as a security practitioner, how has security changed over the last 10 years, and how are you sort of adapting to some of the new threats, the changing threats? What has changed?
So the biggest difference, I think, that in the security landscape, and actually my whole career in the last 20 years, is that the volume of attacks and has increased to the point where it really is just a fire hose. Even in a small organization, there's so many different things out there that you have to use technologies that are capable of adapting and to do statistical analysis on your information stream. In addition to that, the successful attacks have become extremely complicated, and because they're being driven by human actors. There's more and more often you don't have your script kiddies that just download something and run it and they get into your system. Instead, because there's such advanced technology and layers of security and monitoring, we're finding that we can tell when a human is driving and there's command and control, and so the complexity and the way that you look at your systems has evolved to the point where without advanced analytic capability, we can't do our jobs.
So some other practitioners have told us that another big shift is that, you know, you used to put all the emphasis on the perimeter, keeping people out, and now when the bad guys get in, they don't want to be found. You know, they're not making
right.
a lot of noise. They're not doing jumping jacks
yeah.
and saying, hey, I got in. So what role does analytics play in helping you find those types of activities?
So it's amazing to me that the myth that having a bunch of firewalls still is propagated today, you know, the crunchy outside, chewy inside. We actually have multiple layers of firewalls and monitoring capability inside of our network as well as on the border, and a lot more organizations are doing it this way. But also, we keep track of the system logs and the network device logs, and we have all of that going into one place in Splunk. And by doing searches and analytics across all of that data, we can then see activity. For instance, analyzing when the number of systems an account has authenticated to goes above a normal amount, we get an alert. And we do things like that. We get reports that show us that an increase in authentication failures on a variety of systems, not just Windows, not just Linux, things like that. And because we can look at a variety of things like that, we see patterns that emerge to show us potential intrusion activity.
I wonder if you could put your commercial hat on, maybe give some advice to your peers in the commercial world. I think a lot of people I've always said, John, that security and privacy, it's two sides of the same coin. Some people disagree with that, some people agree with that. But I think with all the activity that's come out about Prism and the NSA and so forth, commercial entities are starting to pay more attention to not only security, I think they're always very security conscious, but also privacy. Now maybe they should have been sensitized to it, but you find a lot more business people are more sensitized to it. What advice would you give to your peers in the commercial world, specifically as it relates to the cloud and security?
So one thing I would say is for US-based organizations, it strongly encouraged their security practitioners to become a member of the InfraGuard organization. And InfraGuard is a public-private partnership with the FBI, and they help organizations understand not just cybersecurity, but obviously other security or physical security problems and infrastructure issues around the national infrastructure. But also, they have a really strong component of helping organizations understand the threats that are out there, so that's huge. The other thing that I would say is that we've been talking about defense in depth for years, and we've been talking about for more recent times in security about how you have to have a holistic view of your entire organization and understand how your applications and people work in order to secure them in a way that is effective. But a lot of people are doing this because they think it costs a lot of money. And it can cost money because you have to spend money on expensive commercial products. But if you don't do this, it's that return on investment isn't apparent, like disaster recovery, security. Until there's an incident, they don't want to spend the money on it. But when that incident happens and you're front page news on the New York Times and CNN and Fox News, then your reputation loss and your stock price loss and possibly loss of customers is absolutely going to be more than you spend on moderate controls and security. And so spend the money, spend the resources on getting people trained and have dedicated security people, no matter what size you are.
Yeah, the business case is the reduction in the expected loss, if you will, or the brand loss, which is these days almost a certainty. That you're going to suffer. So it's like backup. It's like backing up your data. You're going to lose data. If it's not backed up, you're going to lose money.
Yeah, people always say, well, if I get hacked. No, when you get hacked, everybody gets hacked. Every national labs, FBI, the CIA. These people we spend a ton of money on security, and we're very, very good at it. And it still happens because nobody can be completely secure. So protect yourself. Monitor your infrastructure, spend the money, spend the resources, and let your people get training.
Now, earlier we were talking about the expense of products like Splunk. The pricing model, if I understand it, is per gigabyte indexed.
Right.
Right, which is...
Per day.
Per day, right. So how do you feel about that model? What works about it? I know there's been some backlash on surge pricing, and Splunk has dealt with that as well.
Right.
But what's your, as a customer practitioner, what's your opinion of the pricing model relative to some others that you might see in the industry, per core or per cluster or, per whatever?
So I actually really think that it works well for most organizations, because if it's per system, or installation footprint, then what happens is you get a big system and then you can't expand because you have to spend a lot more money to expand. Well, what happens though is, what if you start doing more analytics and now your server's slow and you have to, and you have a problem, so you need another server? With Splunk, that problem goes away. And I really like the pricing model because So what I do is, if a new group or project wants to put more data into Splunk, they give me money to expand my Splunk license, and they run a new server. I don't have to pay for a new server, and in some cases, it's a new project, but I have enough license existing, so that project doesn't have to pay me for more license. But they build a new server, I can add servers. Anytime I have a search head that starts getting bogged down, I can just install another one. And the expansion capability and cluster capability, I can do it across as 5 systems or 500 systems, it doesn't matter. And so it gives me the flexibility to meet the IT needs of my organization.
And it's great for Splunk because you're going to increase adoption.
Yes, absolutely. Adoption. Yes,
and well, the frictionless growth, I mean, you can do things fast, and the agility is amazing. You don't have to worry about procuring hardware. It's simply just approving the license.
And in fact, in some cases, we've had somebody, one of our technical architects, he likes doing a ton of data analytics. We just spun up a VM for him and gave him his own search head. He can do anything he wants with summary indexes, et cetera. He can bog it down, it doesn't matter. And so by giving him that capability, then he's helped us expand our the footprint of Splunk in general, because he's realized that this is a good tool for us.
This is why I'm so excited, Dave. We and I always talk about the speed of entrepreneurs getting stuff on the cloud, and just the ability, the friction that's taken away from the inertia of buying gear. Provisioning, just the automation allows a lot of people to do their job. I want to get you a quick plug, and you're giving a presentation here in Splunk. Just give a quick overview of what that is and explain to the folks some highlights of that presentation.
So it's actually based on a talk that I did at Splunk Splunk Live in May in DC, which is also the video is online as well. And so my presentation is tomorrow, Wednesday at 1:45 p.m., and I don't remember the room. And it is a automating operational intelligence using summary indexes and statistical analysis. And so essentially, it's the idea of we have billions of events, and I want to compare my last second of, say, firewall transactions, right, to the mean and the standard deviation of the last several months. How do I do that in a real-time fashion without spending, you know, $5 million in clustering hardware? Yeah. And I'm going to show people how to do that, because it's something that's very real for us in needing to be able to overcome that performance barrier.
We really appreciate you coming on theCUBE. Again, that sounds like a presentation. Dave and I were like just writing notes down. Can you repeat that again? Operational indexes, what was it? One more time. Just a title, it just sounded good.
Automating operational intelligence, summary indexes and stats.
That's the kind of stuff that Splunk gets in the weeds on and automates. Again, this is what, when you see these mega trends, making it easier, simpler, and abstracting away complexities, reducing the steps it takes to get the value. That's an awesome, awesome value proposition. Again, that's hard stuff.
In time analytics, you know, near real time, right?
Yes. So, yes.
No limits.
Absolutely.
Okay, Jesse Trucks, thanks for coming inside theCUBE. Department of Energy, doing some really high-end stuff. Appreciate your time. This is theCUBE, where we extract the signal from the noise and share that with you. I'm John Furrier with Dave Vellante. Be right back. 2 days of live coverage here at the Splunk Conference. We'll be right back.